Hello and most welcome to 1494. We will continue with The Trodden Path with Hans Ruin and his article Faith, Grace and the Destruction of Traditions. And I will just continue where I left off. At page 17. It's the very last little paragraph here. It is important to rehearse this basic reflection at the outset. We've been discussing earlier here the establishment of space of meaning. My own purpose in this regard is both limited in scope and encompassing. I want to outline a reading of some basic notions in Paul from a perspective which combines the approach of Foucault, as practiced in his last writings on the early Roman period. Heidegger's existential phenomenology, as this was used in particular in his interpretation of the Pauline letters. I want to do this also in the more general ambition of reflecting on what it means to read a confessional text from a secular perspective. So as to bring out the meaning of the confessional content in a philosophical mood. Ideally, purpose then is not to project a contemporary agenda onto the Pauline text, but to permit the texts to resonate in a voice that is at the same time new, yet intrinsic to itself. As a comparative context, I will refer at times to Roman Stoicism. and to Seneca in particular, as a critical contrast which can help us bring out the uniqueness of Pauline ethics in philosophical terms. The overall structure of the text is first introduced in general terms, the meaning and relevance of cause project of ancient technologies of the self for interpreting hope. Foucault does not discuss Paul explicitly. I take the route of exploring the Nietzschean background to Foucault, where the figure of Paul holds a very particular place. I then introduce Heidegger's reading of Paul as an alternative strategy. Arguing for its remaining relevance for our contemporary situation. Yeah. Heidegger does not situate his own effort in a historical context of exegetical efforts. Which is true also to a great extent of the recent wave of philosophical readings of Paul. To place us in a more self-reflexive position in regard to the very problem of reading Paul philosophically, I therefore also include a brief overview of the philosophical, teleological significance of Paul in some earlier literature. Only after this detour is it possible to return to the actual reading and interpretation of some of the basic Pauline tropes and concepts. Thank you. what we find is Paul as the original inventor of a technology of the self and a new mode of subjectivity which can be understood only in relation to its temporal historical positioning of itself with regard to the sense of the present and to tradition. Philosophical interest in Paul has focused primarily on the interventions of Alain Badiou, Slavoj Žižek, and Giorgio Agamben, who all published interpretations of the Pauline letters over the last decade. Precursor of a political, juridical, and cultural universalism in an explicit battle against the contemporary forms of relativism.
Thank you.
but also linking his own thought of the event. In the Paulinian doctrine and to the possibility of a new revolutionary politics. The central concern is to delineate the conditions for what he calls a universal singularity or universality as event. This is most pertinent. In 2000, Giorgio Agamben wrote The Time That Remains. Commentary on the letter to the Romans, in which he returned to Paul in order to find a messianic understanding of human existence. That it anticipates some of the most radical moments in Walter Benjamin's thinking.
Yeah, no, I'm not so fond of like the wine or I prefer working with Mark and but I think like if it's to go
Thank you.
in his non-confessional reading of Messianic time as the temporality of the always to come. He senses the possibility also of a community based on dispersal rather than original unity. And in 2003, Slavoj Žižek joined the discussion with the essay "The Puppet and the Dwarf: The Perverse Core of Christianity," partly joining sides with Badiou and taking up in a critical manner the reading of Agamben. In particular, around the issue of how to understand the law in Paul and its relation to love and desire. In particular, around the issue of how to understand the law in Paul and its relation to love and desire. And I would say law is incredibly interesting. Decisive in the understanding. Different ways Badiou, Agamben, and Žižek all share a concern for a leftist political agenda in the present where the different appropriations of Paul could be read as applicative hermeneutical attempts to reclaim the Christian heritage for a radical politics today. Was a testimony to this renewed philosophical import that John Caputo and Linda Martin Alcock gathered the contributions to the aforementioned Saint Paul Among the Philosophers from 2009. Which also includes original contributions by Badiou and Žižek. Together, these works constitute a contemporary hermeneutical situation where suddenly the sense and significance of the Paulian teaching and the historical role of Paul for Western philosophical and political subjectivity and sensibility has become a focal point of philosophical energies in the present. In all these works, there is hardly any mention of what is arguably, and in the longer perspective, a more decisive event for overall philosophical approach to the New Testament over the course of the last half century.
I like that when you've got so many individuals
and in the longer perspective, a more decisive event for the overall philosophical approach to the New Testament over the course of the last half century. And here the name comes, listen now, namely Heidegger's work in the early 20s, some of it in close cooperation with Rudolf Bultmann and his students in Marburg. In 1994, the editors of Heidegger's Gesamtausgabe released the material from his 1920-21 early Freiburg seminar on the phenomenology of religious life. Which centers partly on an interpretation of the letters to the Galatians and the Thessalonians. Seminal course, Heidegger sought to retrieve an understanding not only of what he described as a supposedly original articulation of the Christian life experience,
but it's like you're all genius.
In this seminal course, Heidegger sought to retrieve, but also of human facticity as such, thus integrating a reading of Paul into the core of his analytical Dasein, which was then in the making. And you can see here my comment, there is a close parallel of the Christian life experiences as a sort of archaic original, that the four point when it was not yet taken by the amnesia, the fixation. At the center of his interest for Paul here is the mode of temporality and historicity expressed in the letters, an indeterminate chirological time. Outside ordinary chronology, a time of expectation, waiting, awakenedness, and result. It is easy here to see that Dasein is participating in the evolvement, and as we said earlier, the appropriation of the Pauline letters. Dasein is the one who participates. Dasein is the one who's constantly evolving in the process of understanding. When you go towards the phenomenological horizon of understanding, where your subject, whatever is you, will enter into the objectivity of the text, that is the moment of reading. It is in there where everything happens. Here, the text is true, not as a static original or a methodological, mechanical readout. For me, this mechanical readout sounds a bit like the parochial and almost ironical Yale Literary School of Criticism that apes the construction in a mechanical manner as to make a true reading of any text. Those tendencies has a very dampening and stopping effect on understanding. It makes it fixated. One book I would add briefly to the text is here on deconstructing life worlds, by Robert Magliola. And I found a little passage that appeals to mind here. Page 20, it's a quote from Derrida. O psychomachia mine! Exclamation mark. Who is thus geschlecht? What about the sexual life of your Dasein? Then might have still asked. Derrida, geschlecht, sexual difference, ontological difference. As for self-critique, undertaking it now, and here we have the chronological time put in parenthesis, as it applies to the self, the chronological self, not the chronological, then it is like entering a time tunnel lined with funhouse mirrors, or almost. Is not to say such a task would not be essayed. It is fractured and distended, but still functional. As any working psychiatrist would attest. And a quote there. And this goes to show when you apply the chronological time to any text or any event, so to speak, experience, broadly meant, you will fracture and strangle it. So what on the surface looks like a friendly, gentle, pleasurable gesture of correct reading of an original in a correct way with a methodology is actually strangling of the text. And as hinted here, it's a fracturing of the self as well. So we'll side briefly with Badiou and say universal is possible once we let go of that fixation with the original. It is that fixation that makes it impossible to make a horizon. We will not be able to reach into the text if we are not completely subjective in ourselves. It is that very subjectivity, whatever you are, that comes in use and defies true origin, and it defies a true mechanical method. That is chirological time. This, the text comes alive and speaks truth. And as I said, I would side briefly at least with Alain Badiou. This opens up for universalism, the truth of the text, the absoluteness of the text. And the objection earlier that this would lead to an absolute relativism and going into China and using Taoism or Chinese Buddhism to open up for the Trinity, as criticized by Paul Fredrickson, bearing the very name of Paul. I say this is absolutely wrong thinking. If we take that movement or that staleness too hard, it would pull the rug under ourselves. We would have nothing to stand on.
Oh yeah, it's very, very,
sheer subjectivity and the absolutely momentous, in one moment, chirological understanding, the act of understanding the text. That is what's true. Called it earlier in 1493 for the verbal act of the process. But this is what makes the truth, the possibility of truth. Truth is live, never fixated, never stamped on the surface of something originally signed. I like the Derridean idea of the signature, that sort of makes something authentic, true. It's also a cause and effect idea here, which is very close to chronological time, before, after, and so on. A long bead, like a necklace. I know Slavoj Žižek went deep into these matters. I will not quote him here, but it is interesting how he enters into the text and makes it come alive again. In the end, it is the Dasein, I would say. And it's interesting to see here, in the very making of Dasein, in the early seminars of Heidegger, this, so to speak, seed or germ to Hofung is already present. It's a sort of participating in the etymological archaeology of Dasein. Where did it start? Maybe some common color.
Hello, hello, from Palm House. So who is right? Paul Fredriksson, who thinks that universum is wrong in one way? Or Badiou, who thinks that Paul was a universalist? I think we, as you pointed out, that we should not think about the now. One key word in Paul is kairos, that is, it's the right moment, and the right moment is almost always in the future. And Heidegger said that temporality comes out of future. Temporality comes out of future. There lies the answer, so to say. So you cannot never read Paul as now. Otherwise, it will be stagnant. It's like stagnant water. So, you quoted Palmaliola from page 20. If you would, I paraphrase now, if you would apply now, as it applies to yourself, it is like entering a time tunnel lined with funhouse mirrors. So, you become like a schizophrenic. That's his point. I think that is, if you think everything is now, that Paul is only speaking about the now, and you try to understand Paul only in the precise context in Paul, like, let's say, in the 50s, of Paul writing 50s or 60s, then you will get lost. It will become a stagnant water. Paul was always speaking about the future. And he had to speak about the future because when he dictated his letters to somebody, and it would take time for the letter to arrive to the right person. There's always about the future. It can never be about the now. And as Derrida said, that the signing will occur only when the letter arrives at the destination. It's only about, almost always about the future. And then you can read Paul as a universalist. He wanted salvation for all the people. So Paul Fredriksson, I don't know if she really means what she means. Tries to, or whether she wants only to be provocative. I don't know. Who knows? I don't know. Or she wants to reread Paul as a Paul. I read a review about Paul Fredriksson's book. She's one of the most influential female scholar, New Testament scholar today, Paul Fredriksson. And the reviewer had a nice phrase. She says that Paul Fredriksson is able to make Paul weird again. That is, she would place Paul in the Jewish context. And in that Jewish context, Paul was strange, so to say. But I don't know how Jewish we should make Paul, because he was about the future. If you read Paul in the past, in the now, then he becomes only a Jew, who was a little bit wanted to make a little bit provocations, but he was about the future. So I give it back to you, Hans.
Yeah, most definitely. Excellent. Everything is about the future, and everything about Dasein is, from a chronological perspective, future. This is what we strive for. This is my subject, what my intention is, my wants, my will, everything that is me. Everything of that is projected to the future, the Zukunft. And this is the making of a truer reading, because that could be shared by others. Whereas this, as Kalle called it, stagnant fixation with the now, which is logocentrism with another word, and not really understanding space either. Because the two things, as you said, the letter will be read until, not until it arrives. Very important. Before that, it doesn't have the meaning. There is a sender and a receiver, and there's a time in between. So two things are not clearly understood when it comes to the stagnancy in its time and space. Projecting into something, Noema Gnosis in herself, is future, and in that reality comes. And oddly enough, then we can also have a past and a now. First then, not before. So it's a widening, especially, and deepening, chirologically, temporal, of the text, making it more true, more forceful, more speaking. I think it's time to end there. So if there's no more comments, say thank you very much for your patience and goodbye. I
put it this from April 12th, 2023.
Yeah,
things good. We have a very nice weather.
It's pure tropical in here. As you can see.
Farmhouse from the 19th century in Gothenburg.
Lovely.
Okay.
Bye bye.
Goodbye.